Suprabhatam, friends. In the previous sessions, we were understanding about the greatness of the Upanishads and among them the Katha Upanishad. Initially, we understood through the beautiful story in the Katha Upanishad how a young lad of 5 years, Nachiketa, asked several questions to his father Vajashravas when he was doing a sacrifice and giving number of charity, including the old haggard limpid bulls, to the people who had assembled there. He asked the question repeatedly to his father, "To whom are you going to give?" Then the father became terribly upset and said that, "I have given you to death. Mrutyave tvam dasyami." Then this young boy Nachiketa went to the Yamaloka and waited for 3 days, and Lord Yama returned, and then having seen this young boy or his soul having not taken the food, neither eaten anything nor drank anything, and he was fasting, was extremely happy and granted the 3 boons. He asked Nachiketa to ask for the 3 boons which he is going to grant. Nachiketa first asked the first boon or the vara, "May my father be always happy and pleasant." I didn't know why he was so upset and agitated when he was doing this very big sacrifice called the Vishwajit sacrifice, by which he is going to win over the entire world. Father Yama agreed and granted that. Nachiketa asked, "Shanta sankalpaha sumana yathasyat." May my father be always peaceful, quiet and tranquil in nature, and let his mind be pleasant. It was granted. Then Nachiketa was observing his father used to enkindle the fire and do the sacrifice of the yaga 3 times a day, in the wee hours of the morning, in the afternoon and in the evening when the sun was set. He wanted to know the significance of this fire, which is praised, which is worshipped, which is called Agni Vidya. Vidya, the science of Agni, the fire. Then Yama was extremely happy and granted that boon also, saying the fire is of 3 kinds and it is performed and it is worshipped, through which people can get into the heaven, and this fire acts as a supplicant or a petitioner for all our requests and petitions. So it was granted. Then Nachiketa and also Yama said that from now onwards we call the special fire as Nachiketa Agni. Agni or the fire which goes in the name of Nachiketas. So even now it is some time when the sacrifice is being done, we name that fire as Nachiketa Agni, and that's how it came to be known in the entire world. Then he asked next, what happens to the people after they die? What will happen to the body? I would like to know. Yama refused to answer, saying, "You are such a young boy of 5 years, you cannot know these things." But still he insisted. Yama tried to lure him with the best of the toys available in those days, and with best of the chariot, the best of the horses, the best of the elephants, the various types of jewels and other things. But Nachiketa refused flatly. Then Yama was forced to tell about the secret of the death and the secret of the soul. So he elaborates that. He initially says that this body is made up of, as you are all very well aware, that the 5 sense organs are the 5 and the 5 motor organs. It's made up of manas, the mind, then buddhi, the determinative faculty or intelligence, and also egoism or ahankara. Beyond this is present the soul. Then Nachiketa asked a question. Look at the inquisitive mind of Nachiketa. At every step when Yama goes on asking question, Yama goes on answering, Nachiketa stops him and asks questions. So repeated question, because that is the hallmark of our Upanishad. Tadviddhi pranipatena pariprashnena seveya. Repeated questioning and spirit of inquiry and questioning, which is the very important thing which has to be developed. When a young boy or a girl or our sons or daughters or whoever it may be, brothers or sisters, when they are young, when they ask questions, we become very much agitated and disturbed because we don't know the answer for that, isn't it? So we snub the questions and we will never reply with correct answer. But only through repeated questioning, pariprashna, then pranipada, salutations, and through worship, one can understand the supreme reality as elaborated by Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. James K. Feebleman, a contemporary American philosopher, says that when we are born with these three things: inquisitiveness, curiosity, and wonder. As we grow older or younger and younger, we lose these three traits or characters of the young boys or the girls: inquisitiveness, curiosity, and wonder about the life, about the world. So that has to be nurtured. That paves the way for knowledge. So Yama was extremely happy when this boy asked the question. He asked, which is superior among these things? Either the mind or the buddhi or the intellect or the sense organs, the jnanendriyas or the karmendriya. To which Yama replies. He says, indriyebhyah para hyarthaha arthebhyascha param manaha manasastu para buddhihi buddheratma mahan paraha. He says, the sense organs are very, very important as far as the activities of the body and to interact with the external world. But beyond these five senses and the five motor organs, the mind is superior, because it is the mind which gives the direction to the activities, and therefore mind is superior to the 10 sense organs. Then beyond the mind is present the buddhi or the intelligence or the determinative faculty that classify and distinguishes between good, bad, right, wrong, noble, ignoble, etc. So that is better and higher than that of the mind. Then who is understanding these things? It is I. I am that person who is experiencing and understanding. Therefore, this I or ahankara is superior than this. Then further, when asked, he says, beyond the ahankara, the buddhi and the manas, is present the soul, which is present in the cave of our heart, and which is the minute among the minutest and smallest among the smallest of the objects of the world. And that is the soul or the atma through which we know ourselves and we know outside. Then further he elaborates, Yama elaborates and says that when the body dies, when the body is consigned to the flames, the soul, which is imperishable, indestructible, which we read through the Jnana Yoga today, second chapter, 20th verse and the 23rd verse, Najayate Mriyateva Kadachet, etc. So he says this body is imperishable, indestructible, you can say, Ajo Nitya Shashvato Yam Puranaha Nahanyate Hanyamane Sharire. It is unborn ajaha. Then it is eternal because it is born at all. And Nitya, it is eternal, Shashvata, permanent, and it is indestructible, imperishable in nature. This soul, with its activities of the previous life, which is not elaborated by Kathopanishad, but we get the cue and the answer later in the Puranas, through its activities of what we did in our previous life or lives, that is our actions, which is preserved through the mental impressions or the samskaras, which you can call it as gene now, or the gene expressions. This is carried on from one life to another through the linga sharira, or it is also called the karana sharira. So in that karana sharira or the linga sharira, which is a part and parcel of the atma or the soul, is carried all our actions of the previous life and the lives, good or bad, right or wrong, merit or demerit. And based on the total sum of those mental impressions or the samskaras or the meritorious deeds or the demeritorious deeds we have done, it will find expression and enter the womb. The atma or the soul chooses the parents. Parents will not choose the kids, but it is the soul which chooses the parents. Till then, it stays in the firmament of the sky, in the invisible form. Then it enters the womb and expresses itself, completes its duty and responsibilities, and deteriorates its past karmas and moves on like that. Further, Yama says that sometime this soul also enters the inanimate beings of the world, remains in that position, in that status for a long time, and when it gets the right parents, it expresses, it enters and expresses itself. Therefore, Sri Ramanujacharya, while elaborating his philosophy of Visishtadvaita, or the qualified non-dualism, said that the Brahman or the Supreme Reality has two moments or two parts. One is the animate, the other is the inanimate. Chidachid Vishishtam Brahma Ekameva Tattvam. This is what he said. So chit means conscious, sentient, animate. Achit is non-sentient and inanimate in nature. So these are also part and parcel, he said. And further, then Yama elaborates, saying that this is the secret of death. This is called the Mrityu Vidya or the Atma Vidya. This vidya has to be understood by us, not only just understood, but realized by us later. As long as we are searching for the external realities in the external world, we can never get it, because it is present inside. He elaborates further, saying that only because of it, he writes, he says that this Atma, the sun shines, the wind blows, the fire burns, and the everything happens because of that only. Tameva bhantam anubhati sarvam. That is what he quotes in another verse of the Kathopanishad. Natatra suryo bhati nachandra tarakam nema vidyuto bhanti kuto yamagnihi tameva bhantam anubhati sarvam tasya bhasa sarvamidam vibhati. He says that the sun and the moon are the timekeepers for the universe, isn't it? They are called the Vishwa Niyamakas. So the sun and the moon are doing their duty, responsibility systematically for millions and millions of years. But, and the stars are there, the meteors are there, they are shining in the sky of the firmament. And here and there we find the thunderbolt, the lightning and so on, and the natural process of rain and shine and whatnot. But, and the fire burns with all its energy, with various types of energy. But who has motivated these things to do in the world? Who is the real Niyamaka? It is the Vishwa Niyamaka, is the Supreme Reality or the Parabrahman. And this Parabrahman, only because of him, the sun shines, the moon, you know, dazzles, the stars dazzle, the fire burns. Tameva bhantam anubhati sarvam. He shines first, and that is present within us in a self-luminous way, which it is said that it is Swayam Prakasha or self-luminous in nature. When the power goes off here in this Mangal Mandir, or when you are going back to your quarters at late in the night when there is no power, we switch on our mobile, we switch on our torch to get the power, isn't it, to see the light. But we have that light within us, and that light is nothing but the light of the Atma or the soul, which does not depend on any other light of the world, and it can shine by itself. Therefore it is called Swayam Prakasha. On its own it shines. Swayam Jyotihi. It shines by itself. So because of this only shines the whole universe as elaborated by Yama. Then further, Nachiketa asks, is it possible for us to get this Brahman or the Supreme Reality which you are mentioning by way of words, by speech, by mind? Emphatically Yama says no. He says, Naiva vacha namanasa praptum shakyo na chakshusha asti iti bruvatonyatra kadam tadupalabhyate. He says, it is impossible to get the entire dimension or the concept of the Brahman or the Supreme Reality by our any amount of speech, by any amount of words, not even by the mind, not even by our eyes. Sense organs cannot reach the Supreme Reality. The speech cannot reach the Brahman. Only inward experience. As long as we turn outside to see, it cannot be attained or obtained. It is impossible for us to obtain only by speech, because it is an absolute experience. It is an experiential knowledge, not a theoretical philosophical knowledge at all. Therefore, Naisha Tarkena Matirapaneya, in one of the statements Yama says, this Atma cannot be attained just by logic. Nayam Atma Pravachanena Labhyaha. This Atma cannot be attained by only profound lectures. Nayam Atma Balahinena Labhyaha. It cannot be attained by weak persons. Atma Vare Shrotavyaha Mantavyaha Nididhyasitavyaha. This soul has to be heard, repeatedly meditated upon, contemplated upon. Then only you can get it. Therefore, it was said in the Taittiriya Upanishad, Yatho vacho nivartante apraprya manasasaha anandam brahmano vidvan nabhibedi kudaschana. So, the mind and the speech went in search of the Supreme Reality, but they returned unsuccessfully, without attaining the Supreme Reality. So, it's obvious that all our Upanishads, especially the Kathopanishad, elaborates that we have to turn inward, meditate, and through Adhyatma Yoga, this is the word used, through Adhyatma Yoga, we have to concentrate, meditate, check our senses under control, the five sense organs and the five motor organs, check our mind, exercise our buddhi, because the charioteer is there and the chariot is the body within which is present the soul who sits as an eyewitness or mana sakshi. When that is done, when we contemplate day in and day out, we get the flashes of intuition which happened to Swami Vivekananda when he was very young. Every day he in between his his eyebrows in the Agna Chakra, he used to get the brightness, the light, and it came and disappeared. It lasted for many years. After that, once he was going with his mother, with his parents to Raipur, and he was supposed to go, they were going by a bullock cart from Kolkata to Raipur. When he was going, when he was seated in that bullock cart, they were passing through the ridge of a mountain. There he saw the blue sky, then he saw the beautiful fragrance of the flowers. He saw a cliff or a prapata, and also at that time a honeycomb, where along with the honeycomb he saw the swarm of bees humming with the song, and the valley, the mountain. Suddenly his third eye got opened up, and he suddenly fell into deep joy or ecstasy, and he remained in that status for a long time. After that, you are all well aware, you saw that. It happened again when Sri Ramakrishna gave him that revelation. So that revelation will happen when we open our mind, buddhi, to the inward thoughts, to the inward soul which is present within us, which is the summum bonum of the Kathopanishad. So let us contemplate on these thoughts and move forward.
Bhavet. Om Shanti Shanti.